And I see that the example of Bhaktivinoda Thakur is something that we should emulate in our present times, you know? I see the future of this Hare Krishna movement more in terms of spreading out in Namahat, you know? Small groups of devotees like we're doing tonight, you know? Coming together and talking about the scriptures and chanting together, you know? And there's actually no impediment to this Nam Sankirtan. If people want to do Nam Sankirtan, there's nothing can stop it, you know? Isn't it? Just like if you decide to come together with a few friends and do Nam Sankirtan, nobody can get in your way. And it's not dependent on anything, you know? Sometimes people think it's dependent. It's actually not even dependent on diksha. It's not even dependent on diksha. People can come together and do Nam Sankirtan even if they don't have diksha, you know? There's a lot of stress put on diksha, but diksha is a much deeper thing than people really understand, I think. You know? Diksha is not just putting a banana in the fire, you know? I think this is often, you know, it's like, you know, people want to get initiated into this or into that, you know? The holy name's already there, we can chant together the holy name. And Krishna sends guru, you know. You don't have to go out looking or go to the guru shop, you know. the diksha itself is an ongoing process, you know, isn't it, you know. Gradually the Lord reveals himself within our hearts and takes us back to his spiritual kingdom, you know. But actually all of that also is kind of like a myth, because the spiritual kingdom's right here. He's already in our heart. And we don't actually have to go anywhere. It's not like we have to go back to somewhere over there. You know? Like, we just have to chant. And I think affection amongst devotees is something that we can cultivate, you know, and by chanting together and by hearing and being honest with each other, gradually that affection can develop, you know. So when we're initiated by the same guru, we call ourselves God brothers, isn't it? So God brothers should be ideally closer than brothers, closer than real brothers, isn't it, you know? Of course, you can't develop these things artificially. It's not like you can buy some book in the bookstore on self-help or something like that and make some kind of artificial attempt to, you know. It takes time and maturity, I think, yeah. And for many people, it takes a lifetime of thought and development and chanting Hare Krishna, and then perhaps 2 minutes before you die, some good thought comes, you know. Right, oh, that was it. Now I get it. So, you know. Oh, you know, yeah. And there's of course, the Hare Krishna mantra is the whole center of everything, so it's something that we should never give up, you know. We should always realize that when everything else fails, the Hare Krishna mantra, it can always be relied on, yeah? Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare. Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. And Prabhupada started this movement with the Krishna, Hare Krishna mantra, and Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, his whole business was to chant in public the Maha Mantra and other, you know, mantras. And everything that we do should be accompanied by the Maha Mantra. So the Maha Mantra kind of like swims throughout everything that we do. It's always there in the background, isn't it, you know? Whenever the mind is at rest. When I was in China, I went to China to teach English. And I had to sign a document saying I wouldn't teach any religion or anything like that. In China, they're very particular about that. So I thought, well, I better not take any kind of devotee paraphernalia with me. So I left everything behind. I was very strict. Nothing, I didn't take anything with me, because I realized I wouldn't have a lot of privacy. And I didn't, you know, even in my room, people were coming and going all the time, you know. And they're very curious, you know, the Chinese, they want to know, they're looking at everything, you know. When your back's turned, they're looking through your books, and you know what I mean? They look through whatever you've got, see what it is. So I was very strict about that. I took nothing at all with me. But I thought, so I didn't even have the japa beads, you know. I thought, well, what I'll do is I'll make a vow that I'll chant all the time. Whenever the mind is not thinking about something else, not occupied with other things, instead of having a set number of rounds, I'll chant all the time whenever nothing else is going on. You know what I mean? So immediately I'll... So I got into a habit of that. So I'd sit in the staff meetings, you know, and they're very, very boring. And I'll be chanting, Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna. Yes, yeah, right. Yes, I agree with you, Mrs. Wong. Yeah. Yeah, but it all went well, actually, and I spent 3 years teaching in China, teaching primary school, and I really enjoyed it, you know, it was great fun, yeah. And it gave me a new career as well as a teacher. And then I went on to teach in Japan as well. But I found that actually having put aside everything that was connected with Krishna, somehow or another Krishna came much more strongly to me, you know? So even though I'd left aside all the paraphernalia, because of, and I was having to keep it kind of secret, you know? Because of that, it actually became much more of a strong connection, yeah? And I realized a little bit, just in my own small way, that what the meaning of the vipralamba, you know? That when these things are far away, then you remember them. Just like if you have a girlfriend who's very far away, you carry a little picture, isn't it? And you look and think about her like that, you know? And it becomes, the separation actually can make the relationship much deeper, yeah? So sometimes, you know, you're in bed at night and you turn off the light, and that's the only time to have a busy day. That's the only time you have to think about, you know, Radha and Krishna, about Prabhupada, or about Hare Krishna, you know. But it's nice to kind of come back to that point where it's like, oh, right, the light's off, okay. I can chant now. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare. And then you really relish it, doesn't it? Because it becomes like your secret little treasure. Yeah. Can you tell us something about your background? Yeah. Are you translating books now, are you?
Yeah.
Yeah, from Polish, English to Polish, or?
English to Polish, Bengali to Polish, Sanskrit.
I see. You, so you read Sanskrit too?
Yeah.
I see. So you learnt Sanskrit, wow. So I'm in the presence of a great pundit. So I feel like, I kind of feel embarrassed. Yeah. Are there any questions? Why don't we have a chat? Rather than me giving you a lecture.
Okay, so I have one question.
Yeah.
Because, so who is your sannyasa guru and when did you accept your sannyasa?
Oh, right, okay. Right, well, it's a long story, I suppose. And, I don't know what everyone's affiliations are. I know there's a lot of kind of hostility amongst the Vaishnava community sometimes between different groups. Anyway, it was actually Bhaktivedanta Narayan Maharaj who first of all encouraged me to take sannyas. So in a way I consider him to be my sannyas guru. But that was a long time ago, that was back in 1998, 96 actually it was, yeah. Then I met him again in 2008, and again then he gave me the vanaprast, you know, kind of a red cloth, you know. And then I met Paramadvaiti, and I stayed with Paramadvaiti, and he also was encouraging me, you know. And he's my godbrother, you know. So I was felt very encouraged by that. I had no inclination to take sannyas at all. And I was still hesitating. And then a couple of years back, I went to Puri just for, I was there for Gaur Purnima, you know, and what have you. And I had a very strong vision, I suppose you might call it. And Bhaktivedanta Swami came to me in a vision and handed me his danda, you know, so that's it, you know, like, now it's time, you know. So that year on my birthday, I was actually in Vrindavan, and I was reading a book, it was by Shamarani Jadarani, you know. And in that she describes the methods of taking sannyas. So there are two bona fide methods. One is, you know, you go and get a mantra and what have you from somebody. And the other method is if you feel so inclined, you can do it yourself kind of thing. You know what I mean? You go just like Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati Thakur did. So it was my birthday and various things conspired to give me this kind of inspiration to, I was in Vrindavan. So I took the cloth and I offered it first to Bhaktivedanta Narayana Maharaj, and then I went to Bhakti Rakshasri Goswami Ashram and I offered it to him. And then I went to Radha Damodar and offered the cloth to Srila Prabhupada. You know, these three people I consider to be my gurus, you know, and others too. That's not limited to them. And I mean, you know, the number of gurus is actually unlimited, isn't it, really, you know? And so that was that, you know, so I put on the cloth and started wearing it. But still, I was not satisfied because I needed to receive the mantra from a proper source, you know? So about a year later, I was travelling in Ireland with another sannyasi from the Chaitanya Saraswat Math, whose name is Tridandi. We've got sannyas from Govinda Maharaj. I'm telling you the whole story. I don't know what you're going to think of it, but you can think what you like. Anyway, we were travelling together and he was telling me the story about how he asked Govinda Maharaj for sannyas and how it all happened with him. So just kind of in a playful way, I said, well, would you give me sannyas? And he said, yes. So I finally officially got the mantra and the sannyas from Tridandi, who belongs to the Chaitanya Saraswati Math. So now you have the whole story, so you can broadcast it, do what you like with it.
It's recorded, so.
Yeah. But some groups, you know, they're funny about things like that, you know? Yeah. Also these days it's like, people are funny if you say, well, you have a vision or you have a dream or something like that. You know. But actually, all devotees are spiritually involved in this Hare Krishna movement. I haven't come across one devotee who hasn't had spiritual experiences, isn't it? You know, visions, dreams, you know, extraordinary happenings in their life, you know. It's natural that these things should happen because we're involved with a spiritual movement, you know. If they don't happen, then something's wrong, isn't it? Yeah, something's wrong. Anyway, this movement's a lot broader than some people think. And no attempt to narrow it or make it shallow will make it shallow or make it narrow, because it's deep and it's broad and it's huge and it's vast, you know. And Chaitanya Mahaprabhu's mercy is going out to the entire world, so nobody can prevent that. The doors to the storehouse of love have been broken down. That love will be distributed Nobody could stand in the way of it. You know? They'll all be washed away in that prem. In Chaitanya Mahaprabhu's time, the devotees would greet each other and they would be so overwhelmed, you know, they couldn't even talk to each other, you know. They'd just embrace and they'd shed some tears, you know, and they'd just say, they just look at each other and say, oh, Gauranga, you know. And the other would say, oh, Gauranga. that was the communication, you know. And actually, I find more in general that devotees all over in the different mats, they're becoming deeper and deeper, you know. And there's a less and less desire to engage in kind of this kutarka, you know, this kind of fruitless discourse that just involves, I mean, it's fun sometimes, you know. But it's just about as much fun as a game of cricket or, you know, playing football, you know. But I find, you know, wherever I go, I see devotees are getting deeper and deeper, you know, more and more thoughtful, you know. And they're realizing more and more that this is quite a serious business, but also a joyful business, you know. And gradually they're getting immersed in this ocean of prem, which actually makes you quite humble, you know, isn't it, you know. When you realize how vast it is and how wonderful it is, it's like, you do, it's a natural humility, you don't have to pretend, doesn't it? It's like, you just feel, whoa, you know, and that's, so this is going on, yeah. Are there any other questions? Does that satisfy you?
Yeah, of course, thank you.
Yeah, you're welcome.
Have you got children?
I do, yeah. I've got one daughter, yeah. She's in England.
How old is she?
She has a daughter also.
Oh, so yeah. A granddaughter too.
Sorry?
You have a granddaughter?
Yeah, too. I've only got one daughter and one granddaughter, so. But my brother has children too, so she has cousins, many cousins, so. Yeah, she's a good girl, you know. She's kind of very thoughtful, you know. She confronted me once and said, why didn't you send me to Gurukul? she was a bit angry with me, you know. She wanted to go to Gurukul. Mm-hmm. And I didn't send her to Gurukul. I sent her to a local school, you know. And I was actually quite concerned that she should get a good education. I wanted her to get a degree and everything, you know, because I didn't. You know, I joined the movement before I took my A-levels, and so basically flunked my education, you know. So I was concerned that my daughter should at least go through the whole process and get her degree, you know what I mean? Then she can relax and do what she wants, you know. So I was kind of pushing her a bit, you know. And she did. She got a first-class degree and, you know, now she's got a baby at home. Of course, once you've got a baby, you're looking after your baby, aren't you? But I think she wants to be a teacher, you know. And she's vegan. She's very strict about that. You know? And I think she's trying to make up her mind how she feels about Hare Krishna kind of thing. She's very broad. She's quite broad thinking, you know. So she's not the kind of person who'd be drawn into a narrow way of thinking, you know. She likes the Quakers. You know Quakers?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. They sit in silence for like an hour or something like that. I like the Quakers too, you know. When I was in Ireland, I used to go, there'd be tea and cake in the other room, you know what I mean? And you'd sit in silence, kind of meditating on the tea and the cake for about an hour. And then afterwards, you've got to have tea and cake. It's kind of uncomplicated, you know. Nobody said anything. You know, it's like, oh God, yeah.
Well, maybe
God.
If they slightly would change the focus on God Almighty, so yeah, result yeah. You would get instead of just meditating about tea.
But actually, I mean, I have to admit that I've been hugely eclectic. I mean, after my first marriage kind of broke down, I've been married twice. I shouldn't admit that, should I? But I became involved with a Buddhist group, actually, the New Kadampa tradition. I don't know if you've heard of that. Kelsang Gyatso, he's the leader of that group. Tibetan Buddhists, you know? And I was with them for quite a few months. I lived in their center and just followed their program. Actually, it was very a lot like ISKCON. That was what struck me, actually, it was very similar to ISKCON, except they were Buddhists, you know? They had all the same, there was all the same kind of internal politics and problems. And it was quite refreshing, in actual fact, to realize that it's not limited, you know, it's like, it's a universal phenomenon. But Kelsang Gyatso is a very, very nice man, actually. I really appreciated his company and his lectures. But, you know, he was always talking about how life is short, how important human life is. And you realize there's a lot of similarities between Buddhism and, you know, and Krishna consciousness, you know. His whole thing was, you know, human life is very important, you know, and don't waste your human life, you know, we could die any time, you know, and it's, you know, happiness is all in the way you think, isn't it? You know, we create our own reality. There's no point in getting angry with other people, you know, because they're not the cause of your unhappiness, you know. And this is there, if you read the story of the Avanti Brahmana, you've read that story as well. Same teachings are there, you know, it's the same, you know, what is the cause of my happiness? Is it other people? Is it the stars? Is it this? Is it that? And finally he says it's just the mind. The mind is the cause of our unhappiness. And his solution, of course, is to surrender the mind to Mukunda. So I got involved with the Baha'is when I was in China. You heard the Baha'is, have you?
I did.
Yeah. I like the Baha'is. I thought I really was quite impressed with their organisation. Yeah. They're hugely well organised, you know, very well organised. And they even have a political agenda as well, you know. They've got an idea for a one world government, you know, one world currency, auxiliary language, you know. They've got it all set up in Haifa, you know, they've got a parliament rating, waiting to take over the world, you know. And their preaching is very well orchestrated too. And the nice thing I liked about them is that they accept Krishna as God, you know, as a manifestation of God. So they're very eclectic. And when I got involved with the Baha'is, there was a little clique. I became a member of the vegetarian clique, you know, because some of them had actually read in the Baha'u'llah's writings that Baha'u'llah write that the proper diet for a human being should be vegetarian diet, you know, and that only in times of emergency, you know, and meat eating is allowed. The Sikhs are the same, they also teach that. Guru Nanak taught, you can eat meat, you know, in times of war, you know.
Yeah.
But the ideal diet for human beings is a vegetarian diet. So some of the Baha'is had gotten hold of this idea and they were becoming vegetarian. So when I was there were two kind of, they would have these meetings. Because in China you couldn't have an open religious meeting, you know. So it came in the form of a picnic. So we pretended. They're having a picnic, you know? And we'd have a picnic and then we'd have some prayers and things like that, you know? But there were the two groups. There was the vegetarians and the non-vegetarians, you know? And as vegetarians, we all felt very superior, you know what I mean? We'd be taunting the non-vegetarians, you know? So like, and some few, I think, came over to the vegetarian group. And I realized after a while I was kind of hogging the, I'd always say something at the meeting, you know, and I thought, well, I better tone it down a bit, you know, because it's like, I like religion, I enjoy talking about God, isn't it, you know? And wherever I can get the opportunity to talk about God, Krishna, or, you know, I enjoy it, you know, because at the end of the day, that is the purpose of human life, isn't it? to think about God, to talk about God, to worship God, you know. And Krishna consciousness is God consciousness taken to its nth limit, you know. It really takes you up to the highest limit of God awareness, you know. So, but I had a vision. It was a vision once when I was doing my postal rounds in Glastonbury. I was a postman at that time, and I was out early in the morning, you know, delivering the mail. And it was a nice time because in the early morning, everything's fresh. The air is fresh, you know, and you get up early and you have to sort the mail into its address, and you pack your bag and you go out and you deliver it, you know. So, you know, when you get out of the office, it's like, oh, it's fresh air, you know, it's early morning, you know, it's like, wow. And it's the trees are green and the dew is on the grass, you know, and the sun's just rising. And that's a lovely time of the day, isn't it? You know, the sun is kind of glinting in the dew, you know, and the world looks fresh and green and beautiful. And at that time of the day, you know, also the nice thing about being a postman, what I enjoyed about being a postman was my thoughts were free. I didn't have to think about the post office, you know. I could just chant and listen to, you know, to some bhajans or lecture or something like that. And just, you know, postman, all I need to think about was the number on the letter. Make sure it goes in the right door. So, I had this, it was wonderful morning, I think, beautiful morning. And sometimes, you know, when things are right, circumstances are right, somehow the inner vision just opens up, isn't it? You probably know that, you know, you feel that. There's a moment, isn't it? There's that special moment, you know, and then the inner vision just opens up, you know, and you get this kind of view of eternity, isn't it, you know? And because we actually do live in eternity. The jiva, the soul, lives in eternity, you know. And this is what poets always, they wait for, isn't it? That's that moment. I knew when I was, even when before I joined the movement, because I used to like to write poetry, but I knew there was always a special moment when the eternal and the temporal touch, isn't it?
Yeah.
You know what I mean? It was usually late at night or in the early morning. Somehow or another, it's like the clock stops. And suddenly you realize God is here, isn't that? You know what I mean? Time has stopped. We're now in an eternal moment, you know. And this is the time now to write the poem. And it's like, whoa, you know. And then the clock starts again and goes on like that. So, in actual fact, we do live in eternity, all of us. And there are those moments, isn't it, when the spiritual world opens up. It's like the curtain is drawn back and you kind of, you get a vision of how wonderful it is, you know, the reality of life. And I saw this kind of mountain. It was like a big mountain. It was a lovely vision, actually. And around this mountain, there were all the different religious groups, you know, going all the way up like this. And all of them were engaged in their own particular form of kirtan, like glorifying God, you know. Everybody was there, Christians were singing hymns, and you know, someone else was dancing, and someone else was doing that, you know. On the very top of the mountain was Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, and with all his devotees, all making Hare Krishna. But the whole thing was all vibrating like in unison. There was no discord, you know, it wasn't like, you know, there was one group or another group. It's like they were all adding to the beauty of the harmony of the whole glorification process. You know, it was a wonderful kind of vision, I thought. A very eclectic kind of vision, you know, that everybody is glorifying Krishna or God in their own way, you know. And this is the ideal situation, not that we should criticize this one or that one, you know. It's like everybody should appreciate. That was one of the nice things I liked about Kelsang Gyatso's teachings. He was a Buddhist master, you know. He was very strong on appreciating, you know. We also have in our Vaishnava tradition, you know, if you appreciate somebody else, you actually get some of their good qualities, isn't it? Just by the act of appreciating, you know. So if you think of somebody else and think, I really appreciate that person's good qualities, because of your appreciating that, those good qualities actually kind of spill over onto you, you know. And the same in the other way, if we're thinking about somebody like thinking, oh, he's very bad, you know. Those bad qualities kind of come over onto us, you know. And the thing I like about Buddhism is that they're very concerned about studying things like that, you know what I mean? How the mind works and how these kind of, the dynamics of these things function. Because sometimes we forget that by the mere fact of thinking about a great devotee, we may not be great devotees, but if we think about a great devotee, you know, if I think about Bhaktivinoda Thakur and think, wow, what a wonderful person, somehow those qualities spill over, isn't it? You know? And just by appreciating those qualities, some of that quality comes also in me, isn't it? You know? And whoever we meet, if we can appreciate, you know, yes, are very nice, you know, such nice qualities, then we actually attracting those qualities to ourselves. So the act of appreciation, a lot of things are mental, isn't it? You know, in the Western world, we put a lot of emphasis on physical, isn't it? We forget to actually control our mental processes, you know? But actually controlling the mind is so vastly important, isn't it? And the mind can easily be controlled by cultivating such nice qualities like gratitude. And gratitude is such a nice quality. It's the first quality that's listed in Krishna's qualities. Do you know that? Mm-hmm. It's the very first number one. It says Krishna is grateful. So, you know, it's like gratitude. It's such a wonderful quality. And if we can learn to be grateful, kind of say thank you, isn't that, you know? It's such an ennobling quality, you know? And, actually, I didn't have a lot of contact with Srila Prabhupada. I mean, I was there in 73 when he first came to the manor, and I attended all of his lectures and some of his room conversations and things like that. But since I was just a junior devotee, I didn't actually address him directly. I didn't say, Prabhupada, you know what I mean? I just listened, you know what I mean? I thought, I just listened, you know. But there was a couple of occasions in which Prabhupada spoke to me, you know. And one particular occasion was really, really moving for me, because he just basically thanked me for becoming a member of the Hare Krishna movement. Can you imagine that? You know what I mean? It's like, you know, thank you for joining this movement. You know what I mean? And it's like, well, thank you. But it overcame me a bit because I realized that Prabhupada was grateful, you know, and genuinely so. It wasn't artificial, you know what I mean? He was genuinely expressing thanks, you know, for it's like, thank you for helping me, you know what I mean? And, you know, I need so many helpers. You've come to help me. Thank you very much, you know? And, one of the ways in which Prabhupada always ended his lectures, he'd always say, thank you very much. If you probably remember, you know, that was always the way he'd end his lecture. And it just dawned on me that this was a very, very nice quality and a very rare quality, isn't it, you know? Most people in a powerful position would assume that, you know, it's like, yeah, of course you've come to serve me, you know, because I'm so powerful, isn't it, and so special. You know, and Prabhupada was actually kind of expressing that, you know, that, you know, I really appreciate the fact that you've come and you're here and, you know, you've given up all the things that you've given up. And I also, you know, it's like, I felt he was thanking me for whatever, because I hadn't done anything then, I'd only just joined, you know what I mean? It's like, he was kind of thanking me for everything that I might do, you know? So, and I find that all the great devotees, everyone I've met, you know, they've always been, they've had that very endearing quality, isn't it? That very human quality, you know, it's like this human quality of a gratitude. And I also had some contact with Bhakti Rakshak Srideva Swami as well. When I was in Mayapur, I worked for the Mayapur Samadhi project, you know, Prabhupada's Samadhi, you know, Pushpa Samadhi. So I used to used to go around to Navadeep as often as I could, really, you know, and go see Bhakti Rakshak Srideva Swami, you know, that's what it's like. It's a thing to do, you know. Yeah. And Prabhupada has said that Bhakti Rakshak Srideva Swami is, you know, very expert in the Shastra. So for me, it was just, I was just young and wide-eyed, you know, I wanted to see, meet this. And I was actually there when he explained some important topics like the origin of the jiva and other things like that. A lot of devotees used to go around and speak to him, you know, ask him questions. And I don't remember actually having spoken to him, but there was one godbrother of mine who said he was listening to a tape of Bhakti Rakshak Srideva when he actually heard my voice. So I don't know what I was saying. I hope I wasn't, you know, I can't remember actually speaking to him. But one time he actually stopped and spoke to me, you know. And I was kind of, you know, it's like when someone like that actually stops and speaks to you, it's like you just, kind of you're frozen, isn't it? Yeah, it's like, are you speaking to me? Yeah, like, I was just a brahmacharya, I mean, I was only 20 or something, you know? And he just stopped. But you know, all he said to me was, are you happy? That was all. Nothing more than that. And he seemed genuinely, you know, it's like a genuine concern, like, did you have enough to eat? You know what I mean? Kind of, you know, are you comfortable? Are you happy? You know? Are you happy? And I thought, happy? Yeah, I'm very happy. I'm very happy. Thank you for asking that I'm happy, you know? And he seemed satisfied that, you know, he had focused on me, and I could feel his focus on me was absolute for those few moments, you know what I mean? It was absolute focus on me, you know? He was concerned, you know, are you happy? You know, it's a human concern, isn't that? You know, it's a human concern. And I don't know, sometimes those little things like that seem to be almost more important than hours and hours of technical spiritual instruction, isn't it? And I suppose that's because I'm a bit of a sentimentalist. I like the human touch, you know what I mean? And yeah, like that. Are there anything else anyone wants to
say? Yesterday you said that concentration is like a key to everything, something like this.
Oh right, yeah, yeah.
And since you were also into Buddhism, isn't it that in devotee society we often overlook this very important thing? Like, you know, the first offense is not attentive chanting, for example.
Yeah, that's right.
And,
yeah.
You know, and isn't it probably we lack this in our instructions, that, you know, this is very important, and like this mindfulness, for example, the Buddhist practice, because I find it quite attractive that it's kind of, it's not so much emphasized in our teaching, because we have so many things, and sometimes we can get, you know, carried away with all these technicalities.
Yeah.
And for example, I you know, when my Gurudev said that the best way to chant is just to sit. And it was so difficult because, you know, I was accustomed to, you know, just walking around, and actually this japa walk was just a walk, and there was some kind of buzzing of maha mantra at the back, and when you really sit, you have your, you know, kind of demons out of your closet, and you have to deal with your mind, which is not so easy. And what would you say about this?
So, well, Yeah, there was a time, I'd come back from India and I was not very well, and I was chanting my 16 rounds and everything, but I realized, it suddenly came to me that as soon as I picked up my japa bag, the mind slipped into a mode of where it would think about everything else but the holy name, you know?
Yeah.
It was almost like chanting japa became the excuse to think about every other stupid plan that I had in the universe. And I thought, this is really bad. It's almost like it had now become a switch. You know what I mean? It's like the picking up the japa bag had actually become a cue for the mind just to go off on some kind of a, it's almost like when you get your Gayatri thread out, you know what I mean? And you start, you know, on board, blah, 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 it's like, and you just kind of sit there for a while, like, what happened to the Gayatri mantra? So I thought, well, this is really bad. Something really, I've got to do something, you know. And I actually stopped chanting on beads for a while, just to try and get the mind back into some kind of, you know what I mean, get out of that. It's like a condition, you know what I mean? It had become used to, immediately I picked up my beads, it would go off, you know, and I thought, oh, something wrong here, you know. So it's like you've almost got to reprogram it, you know. So it's, no, that's not, you know, it's become programmed to that. Because in the movement, you're very busy all the day. So you don't actually have much chance to think about things. So when you pick up your bead bag, I found there was a tendency then to think about everything I hadn't thought about before. So I thought, well, it's better to allot a certain special time of the day to recapitulate, you know what I mean? Rather than doing that while I'm chanting japa, you know. So you do have to watch your mind, don't you, you know? There's a tendency to get locked into, I think even with a philosophy and all these things that we accept, there's a tendency to develop a jargon. And then you mistake the jargon for the reality, isn't it? So you just repeat the jargon and you think you've repeated a truth. So from that perspective, I think it's oftentimes to shift your perspective sometimes. It's good actually to, okay, I'll get away from that. I'll look at it, look at things from a different perspective and use a different set of terms, you know? So actually getting involved with like Buddhism for me was, it helped me to kind of shift my perspective, you know? It's like, look at it from another perspective, you know? And you develop another set of terms to describe this thing, you know? Otherwise, you know, we talk about the three modes of material, nature, and the Supreme Personality of Godhead, and it just becomes a kind of a, you know, it loses its immediacy, doesn't it? It's no longer a living experience, but it becomes just a set of doctrines or dogmas or cliches, you know. And after a while, also, another dangerous thing can happen is you start to think that you've gained command of these things by the use of the jargon, isn't it? And this is what happens in religious institutions oftentimes. Someone spends a lot of time becoming very expert in the jargon, and then they think, yeah, then they, it's like somebody who knows the Bible, you know, isn't it? Like you can quote the Bible, and they start to tell everybody else what God's all about, isn't it? God says this, and God says that, you know, it's like, hey man, just knowing the Bible doesn't mean you know God, doesn't it? Or what is on God's mind, you know? So I think these are dangers sometimes, you know? And in Zen they talk about the beginner's mind, don't they? Mm-hmm. It's like this, you've got to somehow, sometimes along the path you have to stop and make an assessment. And you've got to check what you're doing, says, you know, and go back and rethink some aspect of it, you know? Because sometimes we develop bad habits that are not very useful, you know? And so we have to, self-examination, isn't it? It's really, really important to, in that song Gurudev. Who writes that song actually? Is the author of that song? Is that one about Bhaktivinoda song? Gurudev Kripa Bindudya. Yeah. So it's when I examine myself, isn't it? Self-examination, yeah. And I realized actually recently I had a friend who's a Catholic, very devout Catholic, and I was staying in his flat in London, and the whole flat was full of books about Catholicism, about Catholic saints. And I wasn't brought up a Catholic, but I think here in Poland, Catholicism is prominent, isn't it? I was brought up a Protestant, you know, and a Methodist kind of background, you know. But I realized, you know, I looked at some of these books, I looked at Teresa of Avila and St. John of the Cross, and I thought, actually, these people are quite profound, you know. They really have their inner self-analysis and contemplation, isn't it, you know? And these things are quite important in the spiritual life, isn't it? To stop and to assess what is your mental condition, you know? How am I doing on the spiritual path, you know? So I think to be a spiritualist, you have to also be quite psychologically aware, isn't it? You have to be aware of how your own mind works and also about how other people's minds work, you know? Because we're dealing with the mind mostly, isn't it? That's the thing about Buddhism, it's like, there's a lot of talk about the mind, you know, how to control the mind, how to deal with the mind, you know. And I'm not recommending that devotees should take up Buddhist practices. But I think things like mindfulness and stuff like that can be very useful, you know. And that in mindfulness you're just meditating on the breath, isn't it, you know. But if you think of the breath as the Maha Mantra, isn't it? You think, you know, breathe in Hare Krishna, breathe out Hare Rama, or whatever, however you like it, you know. I think it can be very helpful, you know. Some people would probably disagree, you know, but anyway. In my life I found to be eclectic has been very useful for me, you know. I can remember two past lives in detail, and I wasn't a Hare Krishna devotee in my past life. My last life I was a Catholic, and the life before that was a Tibetan Buddhist. But I was on the spiritual path, you know, I was seriously engaged in mostly japa meditation, you know, chanting mantras and things like that. So it's helped me to realize that there are certain qualities that go through, it's not which group you belong to, but it's how you practice and the motives in your practice that are important, you know. Isn't it? Mm. You know? It doesn't matter which group you're a part of, you know. It's got to do with your sincerity, your state of mind, you know. And ultimately, Krishna's guiding everybody because he's living in everyone's heart. So things like guru, people talk about guru, but guru's always with you from lifetime to lifetime, isn't it? You know? And he appears in different forms, but he's always there, you know, he's guiding you through, you know. There's that story about Paranjan, isn't it, you know, Paranjan. And there's so many other stories in the Bhagavatam where Krishna appears to his devotee. And the devotee says, well, who are you? And Krishna says, well, I'm you, actually. And I've always been with you. Don't you recognize who I am? Can't you see? I'm not different from you. I mean, this, some people think this is impersonalist, but it's not really, you know. We are Krishna in one sense. We are parts of him. We're inseparably related to him. He is us and we are him in one sense. You know what I mean? I know as devotees we stress the difference, isn't it? But our guru is always with us. That's the point, isn't it? We're never separated from guru. And the physical manifestation of Guru is an external representative, isn't he? He reflects back to us, that inner guide, you know, who's always there. You know? So we should never ever think that we're separated from from Guru, but never, you know. And Krishna appears sometimes in a physical form, you know. I mean, you know, we think, oh, Krishna can't appear in a physical form. He can, of course, you know. He comes to us in so many ways, in so many forms, even inanimate, you know. But that's one nice thing I like about Tibetan Buddhism, is they say Buddha, always guiding the disciple, he appears in so many forms. Somebody can appear as a tree, he can appear as a dog, he can appear as your next door neighbour, you know what I mean? As in the form of a book, you know? And this way you're advised to think of everything in this, everything is potentially Buddha, isn't it? You know? So everything is teaching you a lesson. But that's also there in our devotional, you know, practice. You think, oh, that's not just Buddhism, that's... Because there's the 12 gurus, isn't it? The story of the 12 gurus, you know? It's like actually everything is guru, isn't it? Everything is guru. Krishna's appearing in everything. So if we're on that platform of seeing things, then we can appreciate that everything is teaching us something, you know? The guru is everywhere, you know? In our next door neighbor, in the postman, you know, in the form of the dog that's barking, and the butterfly, and the bumblebee, you know, isn't that, you know, the crow, you know. So if you're awake to that, you know, it's like, even the crow, you know, that's quack, quack, I think, right, okay, yeah. But the crow has something to tell me, isn't it? The crow is telling me something. How am I going to learn from the crow? When I was in Vrindavan, I had an operation. It was strange, a hernia operation, actually. And it's funny because it was a Food for Life hospital there, and my guts were actually hanging out. You know, hernia, you know, your intestines just kind of pop out, you know. Yeah, so I'm having to push them back in there. Sorry, my intestines fell out. But actually, my father had the same operation, my brother, you know. It's quite common, I think, for men, a hernia problem, yeah. And funnily enough, I was friends with one of my good, very close friends, works for Food for Life in Vrindavan, and they have a hospital, just a new hospital. Mm-hmm. And he said, well, we can do the operation for you. We'll get some doctor from Delhi, from the Apollo Hospital, to come. So I had the operation done in Vrindavan, actually. It's kind of interesting. It's kind of funny, really, because I was there, they pushed a needle in my back, so my lower part of my body was kind of all numb, you know, it just felt like jelly, you know, it's like just from here up, I could feel it, but from the down, it was all like jelly, you know. And then everyone was coming in, kind of moving around, you know. But it was afterwards, actually, the pain came. The operation was painless. But afterwards, after the anesthetic had worn off, then the pain came. And I was lying there in this big hospital. There was nobody else in the hospital, only me. And the nurse was a million miles away, you know. I would have shouted, nurse, nurse, you probably wouldn't have heard me, you know what I mean? She was somewhere over there, and the crows were collecting in my windowsill, you know, so my only company was crows. So I kind of developed a relationship with the Vrindavan crows. I learned a lot from the crows. It's amazing when you're open to that idea, isn't it? It's like, you know, so... Okay, yeah, so you're my company, huh? Tell me about Krishna. And the crow, you know, if you kind of adopt that attitude, the crows will start, slowly they'll start to tell you things, isn't it? No, like, don't demean the crow, you know? They have their own spirituality. Especially the Vrindavan crows, you know. So I think that's an important aspect of spiritual life, to realize that actually everything is spiritual, isn't it? Everything is spiritual. There's no part of anything that is not spiritual, you know? And when you come to that realization, you realize that God, Krishna, is present everywhere in everything, you know, and is speaking to us constantly, all the time, you know. So, I mean, Prahlad Maharaj, he was always talking to Krishna. Sometimes he'd laugh, sometimes he'd cry, sometimes he'd dance, you know. It must have been very interesting to watch him from an external perspective, you know, I think. This guy's mad, you know, it's like sometimes he's dancing, sometimes he's talking to somebody, you know, sometimes he's crying, sometimes he's laughing, and all the different moods. And it's a real relationship, it's not just something imaginary, you know, it's a real, personal, human relationship. And this is something that's come to me just more recently, really, more and more recently, is that God is a human being. He's human. It's we who are inhuman, isn't it? Krishna is totally human, you know? And our humanity comes from him. Because he's human, and we have also the capability of being human, you know? But all those human qualities are first of all present in him. So he is ultimately human, and all his, we call a Naravat Leela, isn't it? All those Leelas, you know, with Nanda and Yashoda and Sakas and Gopis. This is human Leela, isn't it? He's human, he's a human being, you know? More human than we can imagine, you know? And of course, this is what we're looking for, isn't it? We're wanting that. We want to just, actually, all of us just want to be human, isn't it? We don't want to be superhuman. We just want to be human. And Krishna is human, you know, and he wants to relate with us as a human being. I thought, wow, this is quite incredible, you know, that God actually wants to be our friend. He doesn't want to sit on the altar. He doesn't want elaborate prayers and worship, isn't it? He just wants to sit and have a chat and share a Coca-Cola. You understand what I'm saying? Like, you know, it's like, forget all that, you know, we've done that already, you know, you did that already, it's time now, I want to get a bit closer, isn't it, you know, let's have a chat, you know. So it's like, it's all right, well, I'm not quite used to chatting with God, but let's give it a go, isn't it, let's see how it goes. And actually a lot of Christians do their prayer, you know, they, Christians have this capacity to pray, isn't it? You know, to talk to God, you know, to chat with God. And of course we chant Hare Krishna. And but I find oftentimes Krishna wants to be normal, you know. And in the Vallabha tradition, I think they have this, they worship Gopal, isn't it? You know? And they have this process called Pushti Marg, which means, you know, they treat Gopal as their son, you know. So there's many, many instances of this, that, you know, Gopal, instead of staying on the altar, he comes to the table, isn't it? And he sits with the family. He's one of the family, isn't it? Gopal, you know, it's like, he's the little boy, you know? You know, he wants to eat with everybody, he's naughty, you know. One thing I always disliked about God was God is always good. And there's this kind of this tendency, it's like, good, being good is boring, isn't it? It's like in school, the good boys are always the boring boys, isn't it? You don't want to hang out with the good boys, you know? You want to be with those who are slightly naughty, the rogues.
But in this regard, Krishna is also very
naughty. Yeah, that's what I'm saying, you know. That's why I like the Krishna idea, because he's not. We say, oh yeah, we philosophize and say, Krishna's really ultimately good. But the fact of the matter is, he's not good, he's mischievous, you know what I mean?
But children are ultimately good.
Yeah. That's a philosophical, that's a Siddhantic perspective, isn't it, you know? But Krishna likes to break the rules, you know? He doesn't like to be straight, you know? So Krishna Leela is not boring, you know. It's not dull. It has its kind of twists and its turns, you know.
Narayan is a bit boring because he's like.
Well, don't say bad things about Narayan.
No, this is not bad. But then... I'm talking from perspective of Rasa.
Yeah. He's very naughty.
We might need Narayan's help sometime, you know.
I remember reading Krishna book for the first time.
Right.
And when there's this moment when and Krishna and Balaram, they were just, you know, to infuriate other people, they were peeing on the floor, and they said,
right.
Yeah, I mean that's it. I mean I haven't met
God
anything else like this.
Pee.
Yeah.
God doesn't pee. Peeing is a mundane activity. How can you say God pees?
but when I was reading it, I said, well, I mean, I haven't found anything better than this. I mean, even if it was made by someone, I mean, who would have a brain like this to think of a god doing this? I mean, must be something. And this is like, there was like, I melted at that moment, you know.
Yeah.
It was better than Monty Python, anything. It was perfect in that moment. I said, God peeing on the floor and then stealing something. Yeah. That, you know, that smashes everything, right?
And then it kind of came to me that I thought, well, actually, Krishna doesn't want a huge change in my life. You know what I mean? He doesn't want me to become some kind of super, super duper spiritual person. You know? He wants to relate with us as we are. And he sees our peccadilloes, what I call peccadilloes, you know, our little faults, you know? I mean, it's commonly known that faults are not really, I mean, they're kind of an ornament, aren't they? Everyone has their faults, you know? And oftentimes if we have a good friend, we know their faults. And we even kind of like their faults because that's what makes them what they are, isn't it? They're like this, you know, they have this quirk, you know, we call it quirks, isn't it, you know? I mean, obviously, you know, if you're a murderer, it's not a quirk, you know. I'm talking about not about major sins, you know, but about the little idiosyncrasies that we all have, you know, that we sometimes we consider them anartas, you know, whatever it is. We might drink coffee, or, you know what I mean? We might read a woman's magazine, you know. We might like bicycles, you know. But, you know, we think, you know, there's lots of things you feel guilty about, you know. But, you know, maybe Krishna actually likes those things, you know, because that's what makes us what we are, isn't it? That's kind of a unique aspect of our personality, you know. And you find that with the so-called great gurus, that they don't judge you that much as you might think, you know. A lot of people, because the way in which Prabhupada has been presented, imagine that Prabhupada was extremely judgmental. But in truth, he wasn't, you know, he wasn't at all. And he was very interested that devotees should do things that they like to do, you know. And one particular incident stands out in my mind was one devotee who, you know, he had read in the Gita that to please the spiritual master was the perfection of human life and all that, you know. So he went to Srila Prabhupada and said, you know, Prabhupada, please tell me what I should do for you. And Prabhupada said, well, what would you like to do? And he was kind of a bit taken aback, you know. So he went away and thought about it. So he came back the next day. He's like, Prabhupada, you know, give me something to do. Tell me what I can do for you. And Prabhupada said, well, what do you want to do? What, you know, what do you feel like doing? So again, he was a little bit taken back. And again, the next day he came back. Prabhupada, you know, tell me. You know, I want to serve you for the rest of my life and all that. And Prabhupada said, well, what is it you want to do? And he thought for a while, he said, well, I want to make fiberglass mridangas, you know, the Balaram mridangas. And Prabhupada said, very good, do it. So he went away and he did it, you know. So it's like, Krishna consciousness doesn't mean that you... Krishna consciousness is a creative process, you know, and it's a joyful process. And it's not a matter of giving up your humanity, but a matter of developing it, you know. And the truth of the matter is that without a sensitive and human heart, you cannot appreciate Krishna's Naravat Leela, isn't it? Because it's human Leela. So in order to be able to enter into that human Leela and to understand these human pastimes, you know, we have to become truly human. Because to be human means to be divine, doesn't it? That sounds a bit of a... I should probably I'll get some people who probably get me on that one and probably say, no, this is all wrong, you know, saying being human has nothing to do with being divine. I say, yeah, but originally all of these things are there in Krishna, isn't it? Everything that we think is important, our lives and our love affairs and all this, originally they happen there, isn't it? They're part of what we enjoy, what we're involved in, is a reflection of that, you know? It's pratibimba, isn't it? It's a shadow or a reflection. Because the love of mother and son is there, between Yashoda and Nanda and Krishna, therefore it exists here also, you know? And because there it's very special and wonderful, therefore here we also revere that relationship, isn't it? So everything that's there is here. So all the things that are here are there. You know, that's why they're described in the same terms. You know, even the relationship between Radha and Krishna is described in terms of a love affair, isn't it? You know, and the acharyas make it very clear that these two things are very different from each other. One is like gold, the other is like lead. But at the same time, we can only use the same language because they look the same, isn't it? It's visually, it's exactly the same. You know. So what other language can we use but to describe them in the same language, you know? So we can gain some idea of that from what we experience here because the appearance is the same, yeah? But the quality is different, of course, because spiritually the quality is pure love, you know? And on the material platform, the quality is exploitative, you know? So that's the difference, you know? But to be human is... to be, you know, God is human, ultimately. Naravat means he's human, you know. The human form with two hands, you know, a flute, and two eyes, a nose, and all of that, you know. Everything we have, he has, you know. Because he has it, we have it. And that we should understand, isn't it? If it's here, it means it's there, and it's here because it's there, you know? And that's the original form. This is like a shadow cast on the wall, isn't it? Just like there's a flower, and behind there's a shadow of the flower, right? So the material world is like the shadow, isn't it, cast on the wall behind. It looks the same. We even call it the same things, and in many respects it's the same, but one is a shadow, and one is the reality, yeah? Are there any other questions? Sorry, did I address your question at all?
Yes.
All right, okay. I was a Buddhist in the past life. I remember how it felt and everything to be in that tradition, you know? So
some other might raise the question because you said that you remember it pretty well, yeah?
Yeah.
So have you been someone who attained some enlightenment during this life as a Buddhist?
Well, I was very devoted to Green Tara, goddess, you know?
Mm-hmm.
And I think that's the thread, I think, that's gone through my lives, you know?
Mm-hmm.
And one thing I realized is that it's not it's not the tradition you belong to, it's the quality of your worship. You know, that's important, you know. So whatever you might be a Catholic or this or that. It's not the fact that you're a Catholic or you're a Hare Krishna or you're a Buddhist. It's the quality of your worship, you know. And to a large degree, the doctrines involved in that are kind of irrelevant in actual fact, you know. Because they say, Bhava Grahi Janardana, isn't it? He sees your heart, he sees the quality of your devotion, you know. So devotion is there, you know, in all these different religious traditions, different kinds of... But you might be devoted to Maria, you know, or to Tara, or to Radha. Mm-hmm. But ultimately, I kind of... It's the goddess, isn't it? It's the goddess, you know. So I think now, my feeling now is this is the era of the goddess now, mm-hmm. you know. That's my feeling, and again, some people might say this is very New Age kind of conception, you know. But I see now, in the New Age, and in many religions as well, there's a focus on the goddess, isn't it? Goddess, because the goddess is a source of compassion, isn't it? Radha is compassion personified, you know. And we've been through the kind of the male god kind of era, you know, the powerful, dominating kind of male god. And now that compassionate quality is called for. You know? So the goddess is coming more into focus now. And of course Chaitanya Mahaprabhu is both Krishna and Radha. His audarya, his generosity comes from the fact that that Radha's compassion is merged in to his being, isn't it? He is Radha and Krishna together, you know? So that compassionate quality, that mothering quality, comes from Srimati Radhika, you know? And she's concerned about her children, you know? Just like a mother is concerned about her children, you know? And sometimes I think a lot of us have had difficult childhoods, isn't it? Maybe we didn't have good relations with our mothers or fathers, you know. And although we get into elaborate discussions of philosophy and this, that and the other, we might even be very good at being very austere or following some kind of strict sadhana. Sometimes what we really need is just some warmth. Isn't it some motherly affection? Is it not true?
Well, it is. Bhakti is all about emotions.
Yes. Yeah, that's right. That's
the path. It's not dry. Not
at all. No.
Yeah, but my point was because the Buddhists, they believe that you can attain some enlightenment, yes? Like nirvana state.
Yeah.
Or like in Zen, you've got Satori and so on.
Oh,
so, so would you also consider that your life as a Buddhist in the previous life was a success or not?
Well, I don't want to go into it in detail, especially because he's recording it.
So maybe you will switch it off. You can switch it off. Commercial break.
Let me put it this way, that I can remember what practices we were performing.
Mm.
And it was mostly, you would call, tantric.
Nice.
But it wasn't like tantric like they say in India. It wasn't all that sexual stuff, you know. But it's involved with deities and mantras, mudras and other things.
Mm.
And it was mostly connected with what I would call energy work.
Mm.
And it means the energy within your body. And the energy in the environment. So we were involved with the weather, I suppose. That's the best thing you can say. Our focus was the weather.
Mm-hmm.
It seems strange to many people, but you know, if you actually look, for instance, you take this town, for instance, right now. So there's an energy pattern. It goes through everyone's bodies and goes through all the things of the world, you know, it's like goes through the earth, goes through the sky, goes through everything. So most people are not aware of that. You know? So First thing is to become aware of the pattern of energy, to have some kind of expansive vision to see the whole energy pattern, the dynamic, you know? And then you can move things through your... There's a... Here, right? There's a... I don't know, center. They have different ways of talking about it. The Chinese call it a hierarchy, I think. But it's right there anyway. So you can move energy through your body, through this and out here like that. So you can, in that way you can move things, you know? You can actually, it's a form of manipulation of energy, really. But the idea is not to do it for personal power, but for helping. You know, if there's some problem with the weather or something's wrong, like we're having a drought or something like that. So the monks in Tibet were always very much involved with the weather. I don't know, I think all the weather, world weather is all kind of starts in Tibet. It's, kind of, it's the top of the world, isn't it? So, you know, energy work of that kind, environmental work, you know, balancing energies, moving energies, you know, correcting imbalances and like that. It's difficult to explain it, but that was what we did. That was what we'd been trained to do. Mm-hmm. And it was all connected with the weather. Seems weird, doesn't it? But
No, so why? Sometimes about the Bhakti school, you can also say that it's Shakti Parinam Vada, so it means the school of transformation of energy.
That's right, yeah.
So this is like higher level because it doesn't affect only the Maya,
that's right,
but illusory world, but also higher energies, which God is all about his energies, yes.
That's right, yeah.
Very long.
No.
So,
yeah. But yeah, it was interesting for me to go through that process of remembering that. And it's quite vivid, detailed memories, which I won't go into. But what it made me realize is that there's a thread that goes through all of our different lives, you know?
Yeah.
And one life is not separate from the one before or separate from the one after. Thank you very much. And we all have a kind of a job to do. That's another thing that comes, it's like we've all got a job to do, you know? So we're all interdependent and we're all kind of part of a team. And, you know, these days we tend to think of everyone as being individual, you know, I'm an individual, but this is being orchestrated from a higher level, higher platform, you know? So we're a little bit maybe not conscious of what we're supposed to do because we're a bit hazy, we're kind of in the cloud a bit, you know? But the more we realize that actually we have directors, there aren't. In our Vaishnava tradition, we think of, you know, Bhaktisiddhanta, Bhaktivedanta, Swami, all these great, but there are also directors who are directing every aspect of human, you know? Ultimately, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, but, you know, it's like there are people who direct the weather, there's people who direct music, there's people who direct creativity with regard to literature, not on this plane, but on other planes, you know? Just like we have committees here in this world, you know? There's also other committees, and they meet, and they decide, you know what I mean? They make decisions, you know? It's like, you know, they'll meet together and they say, well, there's a problem in Iraq or in America, you know, what are we going to do about this, you know? So they try to infiltrate some kind of information through to help people to become more conscious, you know? So, and each one of us has a job to do, you know, to help in the world, to help to raise the level of consciousness of people in general, you know? And our first job is to find out what we're good at, what we can do, isn't it?
Yeah.
That's why, you know, Prabhupada was saying, well, what would you want to do, isn't it? So our first job is to find out. It's like we've got this instrument. This is our instrument, isn't it? We have to find out, what is this instrument? What tune do I play? Is it? Am I a guitar? Am I a flute? Am I a saxophone? Isn't it? You know, what noise does this instrument make? You know? And then when we know what noise it makes, we can just concentrate on that noise, isn't it? if I'm an oboe, I make an oboe noise, isn't it? And I join in with the rest of the orchestra. And each particular instrument is beautiful. And sometimes in the West we have this idea of we want to be better than everybody else. This is all bullshit, you know? Everybody has his part to play, and everyone's part is perfect. And the only thing we need to concentrate on is playing our part. Isn't it? We don't have to worry about what other people do. We have to make sure we're in tune and that we are playing our tune, isn't it? I play my tune. Not your tune, not his tune, but my tune. And that is perfect because it's in harmony with the whole kind of orchestral piece that ultimately Chaitanya Mahaprabhu is conducting. But it's true though, we are an instrument, isn't it? The most valuable thing we can do is open our mouth and make a noise. So kind of like the human body is a sounding box, so where we say Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. We're making a sound, isn't it? We're vibrating, you know? So the most valuable thing we can do is to vibrate and to learn to vibrate in harmony with the divine. You know, that is my small contribution. But I'm not saying anything new or anything that anybody has not heard, isn't it?
So are you currently affiliated to formal preaching program? Do you accept disciples?
I'm currently affiliated with one wonderful couple over there. Maharaja and Maharani, yes.
So
allow me to stay in their house. But yeah, I'm affiliated with AC Bhaktivedanta Swami, and I'm affiliated with Bhakti Rakshak Shredeva Swami, and I'm affiliated with Advanta Narayan Maharaj, I've met Bodhayan Maharaj, I'm affiliated with Paramadvaiti Maharaj, you know, and Sadhu Maharaj, I know all these people. So, you know, I'm part of the team, you know.
Okay.
Part of the team. I don't work without authority.
No. You mentioned so many of them.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah.
I have no doubt.
Yeah. And I'm very devoted to ISKCON, you know. Really, I am. I'm always concerned about what's going on in ISKCON, what's happening, how things are functioning.
But do you consider yourself as a part of ISKCON?
Of course, yeah. Of course I do. We're all part of ISKCON. They may not think we are, but we are. That's their problem. That's not our problem. Yes, the International Society for Christian Consciousness.
Yeah, so everybody's involved.
Yeah, of course. How can I not be involved? You know what I mean? I'm initiated by AC Bhaktivedanta Swami, you know, it's like, how can I not be involved? You know, they may say, oh, you're not involved, but that's their problem, not my problem. Do you follow the GBC? Of course I follow the GBC, yeah. I know the GBC out there. Yeah, the real GBC. Should we chant a bit more then? Or anyone else has got anything else to say? Would you like to add something, Don? I'd love to hear you say something. You know, tell us something about your life or your feelings or how things are going with you or what you're doing.
Back in Mayapur, I had the same, similar realization to what you mentioned a moment ago. And I felt like, what am I good at? I thought, I'm good in this, that, but like in slightly this, slightly that, in many things, but in nothing at the same time. So then I thought, how can I actually serve the mission And I thought it would be nice to develop in one particular direction. We have this ikeha focus on something, and then give more than just giving bits and parts somewhere, anyone. And then I've realized that the thing that I was doing throughout my life was writing and learning languages and poetry. So then I decided that I would just develop in this area, and I carried on, and I feel happy.
Right, yeah.
And I decided to invest in energy in studying in this area, so I just keep on developing.
Nice.
And that makes me happy. And I think when one finds this idea, what I can really contribute, it gives a lot of energy to develop also and to serve in a way that to your best, yeah, to the best you can. So that's my little
Basha.
Nice. Yeah, I mean, we're all given that opportunity, aren't they? The great devotees never do everything, do they? They leave work for us to do, you know? And that's how we become perfected, of course, by doing our bit, isn't it, you know? And it is very personal. It's a personal thing that it's development that comes through many lifetimes, isn't it, you know? Not just one lifetime, but many lifetimes. And it's highly personal. It's highly personal. We're each of us on our own path, in a sense. You know? But at the same time, we're busy with other people too, you know? And because we're all interconnected, we're all linked to each other, you know? I think a lot of things that Buddhism can offer, actually, that idea of interconnectedness, isn't it? That everybody's linked. Very useful idea, you know. It helps us to realize that, you know, that in this, you know, in the West, we have a competitive tendency, and that we're always competing, you know, with each other. But the spiritual conception is not a competition, you know, but it's cooperation, you know, and everybody has something to contribute. You know, there's no need to envy another person. And you, if someone's better than you at something, you don't have to be jealous. You can appreciate their qualities, you know, what they've got, you know, what they can do, you know. Because it's all marvelous, isn't it? You look at an ant, what an ant can do. It's like, it can do things we can't do. A crow can do stuff that we can't do, isn't it? And every skill that somebody has, you know, it's just, you can only marvel at it, can't you? You can only say, wow, how do they do that? You know, so, well, even if you ask them, they won't be able to tell you how they do it, because a lot of things are just there, isn't it? So, well, I don't know how I do that. You just do it, isn't it? You know, a dancer will dance so beautifully, and say, how do you do that? So, I don't know. Just do it, isn't it? You know, I don't know. It's like, it's just given. It's a gift, isn't it? You know, someone who's good with languages, you say to them, I think, how come you're so good with languages? I don't know. It's easy for me, isn't it? It just comes easily. Somehow I've been given that gift, you know? Some people can do amazing things, you know? There's one lady in Ireland who's kind of Catholic, she talks to angels, you know? Even the Pope goes and speaks to her, you know what I mean? How do you talk to angels? I don't know, I'm just a housewife. I don't know. They just come, you know what I mean? They just come to me, you know. So how does that work, you know? I never managed to talk to an angel. I used to have a ghost that used to come and talk to me. I was in Ireland. And I could hear his voice very distinctly. He was a local man, I think. Must have died in the neighborhood. He was very, very funny. And as a ghost lady, he could go and see different. He knew the whole neighborhood, so he'd bring information about the entire neighborhood. He'd come and tell me about what everybody was doing. it was just
and socializing.
Sometimes I'd have company. You know, people would come and sit. And he'd start talking to me, and I'd say, shut up, yes. I've got company, can't you see, I've got company. But he'd say such funny things, you know what I mean? It's like real Irish humour, you know what I mean? It's like, you start chuckling, it's like, you know, it's like... But there are more things in the world than we can see, you know, that's the thing, isn't it? You know, more things in the world than we can see. I think that's coming now. Rupert Sheldrake, you know, has written some amazing books. You know? You know what, the scientists are gradually getting there, isn't it? You know, with all their scientists, we're always bashing the scientists for saying the scientists this and scientists. But actually, I think that it's the scientists who are finally coming to some kind of clarity. You know, because they've given up religious dogma, and they're trying to pursue truth in an objective way, but slowly they're realizing that it all comes back to consciousness, isn't it? But they're coming to those conclusions with a mind that's free from other prejudices, you know? They haven't got some kind of religious prejudice, you know? So they're coming round to those conclusions, and if they're honest, they're able to accept those kind of conclusions, you know? Prabhupada always used to say this: Krishna consciousness is very scientific, isn't it? And that we should present it in a scientific way, you know? Not as some kind of religious sentiment, you know, fanaticism or dogmatism, you know? But we should approach it scientifically, understand it scientifically, you know? As a reality, not as some kind of, you know, set of beliefs. It's not a set of beliefs. You don't have to believe in anything. This is a reality. You know, this is a reality. And it's a reality to be experienced, not to be believed. I think it's another aspect of Buddhism I find quite relieved. Buddhism doesn't have a doctrine. There's no dogma. Mm-hmm. The idea is there's a process. It's a method, isn't it?
Yeah.
You follow a method and you realize something, isn't that? And you, then that knowledge is yours, it belongs to you, because you've experienced it, you know? So I think in Krishna consciousness too, Prabhupada was often like that. He said, don't believe me, do it, you know what I mean? And you'll experience it, you know? And then when you've experienced it, then you can tell others about it and say, hey, this is not just my imagination, this is a real thing, this is real. Try it, you know, have a go. See what you feel about it, you know? Because there's nothing worse than trying to shove a whole bunch of doctrinaire ideas down someone's throat, you know? You've got to believe this and you've got to believe that. In this age, people automatically rebel against such, you know? They'll automatically say, don't tell me what I have to believe in, yeah, isn't that? Yeah. Go and get lost, you know? You're telling me what I have to believe in. I believe in what I see, what I feel, you know?
I think, unfortunately, devotees, they fail a bit in presenting the Krishna consciousness in the way, so in the framework you are just talking about.
Mm.
Because Buddhists, they've been much more appealing in their approach, even to scientists.
Yeah,
because
right,
it wasn't a shame to be a Buddhist, being a scientist, because of this approach, and so experiencing the things.
Yeah,
and with devotees, they've been presented maybe unconsciously sometimes, maybe because of many different factors, but they've been perceived as a religion. And religion is always connected with some dogmas. And,
yeah,
and therefore, still, I think people, they've got in mind that, oh, Hare Krishna, this is religion, yes. This is like kind of Hinduistic, maybe,
yeah,
background or something like this.
Yeah.
Buddhists, they still have this, I don't know, advantage, yes?
Because maybe the Buddhists, the reason the Buddhists, they speak about methodology, and we are speaking too much about the goal. And
yeah,
the goal looks like whatever other kind of religion that is,
yeah,
there. I think that is the answer.
for this? Because you said, okay, God is the super goal. Okay, then every religion said that God is super goal, but how can I check it?
Yeah.
Then.
But ultimately, Krishna is very attractive.
No.
Yeah.
Yes, he is.
So, I mean, that's what gets you, isn't it? Like, you know, I like Krishna.
One denied.
Yeah. But that's not dogmatic either, is it? It's not dogmatic.
No, it's not. When you know this tradition, yeah. It's certainly
yeah.
not dogmatic.
Yeah. Then you just think, well, let everyone be attracted to Krishna, you know?
Mm-hmm.
And all you have to do is present Krishna in a way that's attractive, so that people will be attracted,
yeah.
isn't it? You know, which, present him as he is, you know, as naughty boy. You know? And then people will, well, they think, whoa, that's nice, I like that, that's novel, you know what I mean? That's different, you know? They will be attracted, you know?
And he has an existential crisis, and so, you know, and so do we, right? So.
Yeah, he worries about whether he's God or not.
Yeah.
Am I God or what? I mean, that's the wonderful thing, really, is that Krishna gives over his omnipotence to Yogamaya, isn't it? Yeah. He kind of gives, he deputes Yogamaya, he said, look, I don't want to be God, you arrange it, you know what I mean? And I'll play Mugdo, isn't that what I mean? You know?
Yeah.
And I mean, that, oftentimes people find that paradoxical, how the supreme omniscient Godhead, you know, can be bewildered, isn't it, by his own potency.
I really know everything, so what's the play? You know, you have no fun. There's
yeah.
no fun with knowing.
That's
right. You know everything, all the movements, yes?
Yeah,
all the
yeah.
attitudes, emotions, and so on.
Yeah,
so
yeah.
therefore, when you compare Krishna, all moving, having relationship with Brahman, for instance,
yeah,
so
yeah.
Brahman
yeah.
knows everything and knows everywhere.
Yeah.
What it is? It's boring.
Yeah.
So,
yeah.
I really found it cool when I read the part of Krishna describing Krishna as Sadhana.
Krishna's what, sorry?
Sadhana.
Oh, right.
Yeah. So he meditates for himself.
Yeah, that's right.
That's
so
that was
all right.
Yeah.
All right. Me.
No, but actually there's a very nice, we heard this very nice explanation from Tripurari's family.
Right, yeah.
He said that after some time, it's similar like with us, that we come hold our mind in thinking about Krishna. So what Krishna is doing, he's also, his mind is like walking all around, but he's thinking about Vrindavan. And that's about his devotees, what
yeah.
are they up to now, and so
yeah.
on. So he can also can't concentrate on his
right.
meditation.
Oh, yeah.
So that's very special about him. He's not far from us.
Yeah. Sure, yeah.